Welcome, I'm Glen Anderson, producer and host of this TV series, Glen's Parallax Perspectives. This series explores a wide variety of issues related to peace, social and economic justice, the environment, and nonviolent social change. We especially provide opportunities for the public to hear voices and viewpoints that are rarely heard in mainstream media. Mainstream media, politicians, and culture see the world in conventional ways. The establishment is stuck in how they see the world. In order to solve problems, we need to see things differently. This TV series, Glen's Parallax Perspectives, can help us see things differently so we can solve problems at all levels, from the local to the global. This series is called Glen's Parallax Perspectives. Here's what the word parallax means. Put one finger in front of your nose and another finger farther away. Close one eye, then open that eye and close the other. Your fingers will seem to move. This is called a parallax view. This TV series invites you to look at issues from fresh perspectives. Also, see much information about the issues that we cover in this TV series and previous episodes of this series at my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. And now I invite you to watch this month's program. None of the positive changes that have happened in our nation's political or social lives were gifts from Congress or from big business. Women's right to vote was not a gift from male politicians. Women won the right to vote only because they organized vigorously and effectively. Labor unions, better pay and benefits were not gifts from big business. Workers run those only because they organized vigorously and effectively. Environmental laws were not gifts from government and big business. Environmentalists won these only because they organized vigorously and effectively. Likewise, the victories for civil rights and many other serious issues were won by smart, courageous, nonviolent grassroots organizing. This month's interview on Glen's Parallax Perspectives will help you become more effective in working for the political, economic, and social changes that you want to see. Two guests and I will share insights that will strengthen your ability to organize. I'm happy to welcome two savvy organizers with experience working on a variety of important issues, Holly Gwinn Graham and Bob Ziegler. I've enjoyed working with both of them for many years, and I respect both of them very much. Glad you're here. We will have a good time.
Thank you.
Thanks.
First, I want to just lay out a fresh way for us to see the power struggle that exists between grassroots people and the people who have the official power. And then I'll ask our guests to comment on how they see this. The typical way of understanding power is a pyramid with a few powerful people on top and the rest of us at the bottom. This puts us in a subservient and powerless position, so we have to ask the people with the official power to please do us a favor. Instead, we need to turn that pyramid upside down so we, the people, are on top, and we recognize that. As Thomas Jefferson and our nation's founders understood, we, the people, actually have the power. With this model, we allow official people to use our power only as long as they use our power responsibly. If they mess up, we take our power back from them. We, the people, are in charge. Bob, how does that pyramid model sound in contrast to what the assumption?
Well, I think that, you know, being able to start at the bottom and to build a base in doing things is extremely critical. And those things that have worked for a long term have started and continued that way. Coming top down, that's like the trickle-down economic theory. It doesn't really work. Mm-hmm. And if you're going to empower people, you need to start. And it's just like going on a hike. You've got to, you know, you always go at the rate of the slowest person. The smallest person is in front leading the hike, that has the shortest stride. So, you know, and it's the way in which you've got everyone covered. You come together and you travel together.
There probably are a lot of other metaphors and examples that would have a similar lesson for them. When people who have the official power and think they're on top fail to solve a problem, there's a smart way for us to empower ourselves and move a majority of the public to solve the problem. And first, we have to make the issue a hot issue that society has to deal with on the public agenda. So the public, the media, and the politicians absolutely must deal with that issue seriously. And second, we have to educate the general public to understand that the status quo is not solving the current problem, and that we get the public to agree with our remedy, our suggestion for the solution, instead of what the status quo system is giving us. And so this includes peeling people away from sort of the default position that they'll accept the status quo, get people to question that, show that our solution is better and serves the public's deeply held values, and then we win the hearts and minds of the public and we solve the problem.
So that sounds perfect. Yes, we hope to, don't we? We often step in and we're not understanding what other people are going through. And I think that's a very important thing, is empathy, but also is an understanding of the issue. And there are many often involved on a very different level. And when you've got that inverted pyramid, which I'm not quite ready to leave that image behind, there are the people here who are making the movement happen. They're the grass. And the roots are reaching down into the next layer and the next layer until hopefully we reach the leaders who can actually do something for us, but they have enough impetus at their backs, I suppose, like wind, to see them forward in a direction we want them to go. And it's a safety issue, but it's also an intelligence issue, and it's an empathy issue, I think, as well.
But also we can do things even if the leaders aren't willing to act. You know, there's the way in which cities and states have taken on the climate issue in the face of the Trump administration. There is fighting it. There's the way in which, you know, I saw down in El Salvador where peasant women organized, and they knew what was right and what was wrong and weren't going to settle for what was wrong anymore. And these were all at the bottom, but they restructured their society bottom up and pulled that off, and they did amazing things, from environmental restoration to there was an art school for kids that were in gangs, and you know, reducing violence in their communities. So this all happened. This is in spite of everything at the top working against them, their government, our government, the international economic order. But people at the base connected.
The
people have more power. I forget the quote.
There's more power than we know.
We have more power than the people in power. The power of the people is greater.
Than the people in power.
Than the people in power.
Well, you know, starting with people's firsthand experiences and values is a good starting point.
It's essential.
That's got authenticity to it.
What I remember about that movement, too, and also the Chiapas movements, you know, and was the art that was involved as well. The giant murals everywhere. Yeah. The mobiles that had, you know, art, and the moving vehicles, etc. It was a bringing together of all of those influences.
Yeah. I want to take this kind of creative alternative thinking and apply it to the concept of democracy. Pretty much everybody in our nation says they support democracy, but a lot of Americans say that our nation is not living up to that value of democracy. And could you share something of your sense of democracy for the context of what we're talking about during this hour?
Marion Wright Edelman recently said something about creating America, and we're still creating America. Langston Hughes said, America has never been America for me. And you can understand why when you look at it under the lens of racism, which has never gone away and is still being worked out over and over and over again in various many ways. I think that it's really an ongoing struggle. Democracy is not a done deal, is it? We're constantly shaping it and creating it. There's something in spirituality called imaginal cells. When you are part of something that is greater than you, but you are a cell in that body that is creating a vision that is something that will be you, something you can step on, even though it looks like you're on the tightrope and you're holding the end of it yourself and you're out over the distance and the height. If you've got friends and you can carry that tightrope with your own intention, you can make it across a chasm. You can make it across a movement. You can create a movement. And you can bring other people in movements together, which is where we're really at now. We're really at that crossroads. I mean, how many of us would love to go and help the kids on the border? If I was Jeff Bezos, my billions would be spent to build them something decent to live in until we can get them out of ISIS control. But who has that power? We call, we write, we speak, we sing, we do what we can, and we hope for the best, you know, and we hope that we'll connect. I think people are working on democracy and working on the face of democracy.
I really like your sense that this is like an ongoing thing, because the next point I was hoping to make was that, you know, we think about democracy like voting, but voting happens once, and then there's a long gap between you before you can vote again. And we actually need to organize at the grassroots and practice democracy in a meaningful way continuously over the long haul and in very profound ways. So voting happens occasionally, then when it, then it's done. But it's more important, I think, to organize grassroots movements that will build and grow over the long term so that we are doing democracy. In fact, that was the name of Moyer's book, Doing Democracy, where he talks about this ongoing process. And the three of us and a lot of other people have been doing this, of course, for decades. And I'm hoping that people watching the show will kind of get a fresh way of seeing things. I define organizing as working with other people to make good things happen. We're organizing as working strategically in groups to make progress toward social and political change. And Bob, I know you have a long background in this. How do you see grassroots organizing in the context of what we're discussing here?
Well, in a couple ways, as continuing on the democracy theme, I was kind of and the way in which things you need to keep working on. It's like that. I was kind of surprised to learn that we're just one state away from passing the Equal Rights Amendment.
Yeah, and we were back in the 70s, one step away,
but
one state away.
No. There was two came on in the last year.
Oh, that's right.
So there was. I had kind of given up hope, but you know, it's still there, and not that far away. It's, you know, there is so much, you know, requires us to be, you know, persistent resistance, be able to be part of the struggle for the very long term.
Yeah,
and not give up.
Yeah, that term you use, the persistent resistance, comes out of Latin American liberation struggles, and it's a great concept. The persistent resistance—it's just you just got to keep at it, and when people do it right, they do make some progress, even when they get beaten down. When we were preparing for this interview, Bob, you said it's useful to know about some methods that were developed in the past. And you mentioned Saul Alinsky's model. Rules for Radical was the book that lays that out. Bill Moyer's Movement Action Plan about long-term vision and strategizing for movements. And certainly Gandhi and King and other people have done long-term organizing models of how to make this work. And people keep expanding on and learning from past movements. I really like a book that I read a few years ago called This Is an Uprising. And I'll mention that in the blog, my blog at the end, when I list resources, so people can check that out. But the Engler brothers, Mark Engler and Paul Engler, studied previous movements and how they learned from each other. So each movement would look at the folks who were doing organizing before and say, well, that's cool, but we can tweak this aspect of it and make more progress, or make progress faster, or tailor it to our current situation or whatever. And it's a very informative and inspiring book called This Is an Uprising. I really appreciate that. We live in an era of instant everything. And so many people just jump from one thing to another, and this does take persistent resistance. And we need to wage our social movements in a deliberate and strategically smart way, understand the problems deeply and thoroughly, set goals to change the power relationships, and inspire people to join with us, devise smart strategies for reaching the goals, and then make some short-term goals that are interim steps toward the longer-term goals, so we can build on those short-term struggles, inspire people with, hey, we won this, now let's do the next step. And you talked, when we were preparing for this program just a few minutes ago, you talked about finding a cause or discovering something that makes meaning for you, and then connecting with other people. Tell us some more about that approach, Holly.
Absolutely. I have been lucky enough to study with my late husband and the works of Gurdjieff. I didn't mention this to you, but Gurdjieff is one of the great democratizers. But also, I learned about Native American issues when I was living in England, believe it or not, and became very involved in those. When I came back to the United States, got involved with the American Indian Movement. That was one small thing I did to try to help what was going on at Wounded Knee. I also have been privy to marvelous information and work done by people in the anti-nuclear movement all over the country and in England, and have worked with many people we'll discuss later, I hope. But I have seen causes that I could identify with, and I want to understand where my place is in those. And often it's getting involved by petitioning or gathering people together or having a meeting, but often it's about writing a song and doing that and teaching something in that song. So I have several different ways of going about it. And, you know, as you know, we'll talk later about the grannies, the raging grannies. We wear wonderfully funny hats, and we say awfully serious things in a very funny way, and we're right there in the face of power. Yeah. I love humor, don't you? I think we have to never forget that it can be a good time, not just a bad time with a lot of trouble. So, I have been drawn by causes, and there are people with whom I feel connected to this very day because of that work.
Yeah. I know you have roots in Skagit County, which is four counties north of where we are here in Olympia. And in the 70s, was it in the 70s you moved there?
I did.
And the people there were already organizing to prevent a nuclear power plant from being built on the beautiful, clean Skagit River.
Ever so nice. 10 miles from a town, Burlington, and in the midst of an earthquake zone. So it was a struggle. For 6 years, there was the Magic Skagit Music Festival, and that was a coalition you've been speaking about.
Yeah, and we'll mention that in a moment. But the values and the visions that people came from, the motivated folks, I mean, that for all these things that people are doing that matter, I think a lot of that comes from values they hold and visions they want for the future.
Absolutely. And as you grow, you change. But hopefully your heart is the same, and your heart has that intention of being on the side of what will last and what will be worth inheriting for the children. And it's true. And, you know, people are drawn together from bakeries and from the co-op and from the gardens and from the businesses in town and the places that don't want to see their wild and scenic river become ruined by a nuclear spill, and for example, and all of those things matter.
What happened? Oh, go ahead.
It's so important, speaking truth to power. And I was working professionally and reviewed the environmental documents for that, and they were arguing there was no need for even an environmental impact statement.
That's right.
The Forest Service, and it was just ridiculous that you could reach that type of conclusion looking at the evidence involved. But all the people speaking truth to power, and the way you use music and other things to involve that, and everything that happens, it doesn't happen top down. I was working with a bureaucracy. You know, we could do review and provide comments, but the thing that made the changes were the citizens, those that would go and be at the hearings and those that were marching.
Yeah. I went to many a Puget Sound Energy, Puget Power meeting too.
Yeah, that was the capitalist
spoke to them in
electric
their
utility
layers.
that oppresses us here.
Yeah.
That was a 6-year struggle. And what happened on election day? When it went to a county ballot, county vote.
We finally got it on the referendum.
What happened on election day?
On the election day itself, when the people went to vote, there was an earthquake on the site, on that wild and scenic river, on the site that Bacchus Hill. And on that very site, the earthquake, a great whoosh of water, and everybody went, oh, we must have been right. It was a wild and scenic river with an earthquake fault. Wow, aren't we lucky that we got rid of that in time. It was just such a wonderful thing, and everybody was so happy, and we celebrated for a long time.
Yeah. Celebrating the victories is very important, too, and the movement is sustaining it over periods of time.
Yeah. So often when we deal with these serious issues like that, the climate, nuclear weapons, endless wars, fascist tendencies in the current administration, people can get bogged down in a lot of doom and gloom. And part of the trouble with that is that it can depress people in the movement and the public as a whole. It's just too overwhelming, too awful, and so people don't want to deal with it. And what we need to do is confront it and take strong actions, strong nonviolent actions, but not just protest what we're against, but say, this is what we need instead, and here's what it is in my heart that causes me to want this other thing instead. But it really is up for grabs. And I know when in 1982, when President Reagan was threatening the world's survival with this nuclear weapons mania that he had, Bob and I and hundreds of other people locally worked with the Thurston County Nuclear Weapons Freeze Campaign, because people were really terrified that Reagan was going to just blow up the world. And the campaign, the Thurston County Nuclear Weapons Campaign, could have said, the Freeze Campaign could have said, holy crap, we're going to blow ourselves up. But instead they chose a positive and witty slogan for the campaign that says, ain't it great to be alive? Oh. And it just flipped the spirit of things so that people could join together. And we won with a 62.5% majority on election day in November of 82.
And what did you win? What was your referendum?
We put on the ballot the Freeze Campaign wording that had already passed in local governments in parts of Massachusetts and other places that says the United States should just stop. Mm-hmm. Just stop. Because what happened was people were arguing, well, how many megatons and how many missiles and which kind of missiles and how much throw weight? And, well, I want to argue with you about those numbers and these numbers and these other numbers and stuff. And the Freeze Campaign said, just stop building them, stop deploying them, stop testing them, just stop. And it was a clear, clean message that the public could say, oh, I can go with that. Let's just stop.
Yeah, I remember the Freeze. And I was still in Skagit. And didn't you have also the nuclear free zones happening here, or was that later?
We had one here later, and they were happening in different parts of the world as well. That was sort of an on again, off again, had some technical complexities.
One thing I wanted to mention is, this was back when I was in college. I don't remember much of college, but I do remember there's this history class. I don't remember, the professor said, if you don't remember anything else, remember this. And it's the only thing I remember from his history class. But anyway, he wrote on the blackboard, hope equals revolution. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, there was, he did his research on revolutions and his historical changes around the world. He said every single one happened not when things got so bad, but when people saw a way for things to get better.
Right. Yeah. Well, historians have talked that in areas of the world when people were shaking loose of the colonial empires. When things were really, really bad, people were just trapped. But what caused people to rise up and cast off the colonial empires was what historians have called the revolution of rising expectations. When people say, oh, we can turn this around. Oh, we can shake off that oppression. Mm-hmm. Oh, we can rise up and empower ourselves. That's what allows people to make the progress.
And that's what King did too.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, all kinds of metaphors about the promised land and the spiritual faith and the music and the community that the people had. And also the nonviolence. When we were preparing for the program, and I was asking you, Bob, what are some things that we might want to talk about, or some good lessons learned about how to make these changes. And you said be principled. And that's what we need, is we need a good grounding in principles such as nonviolence and democracy and human rights and human values and so forth. Let's see.
And communication.
Yeah.
Really good communication, yeah. Understanding what's yeah. about clarity and what you're on about.
And good listening to other people, including people that you disagree with.
Yep. That's hard, you know, but yes.
That's hard, but all of this is necessary.
These days it's hard for me.
I think it's most important, you know, there was even taking nonviolence a bit further into respect for the adversary. Mm.
Yes.
That doesn't mean you back off
yeah.
or give way, but you respect the basic humanity of the adversary, and you try yeah. and draw on that humanity as yeah. much as possible.
Yeah, and you can kind of move things. When Martin Luther King was doing all of his great work, he was suffering a lot of violence, and the people in the movement were suffering a lot of violence. There's all kinds of horrible stuff going on, but he never called any of his adversaries evil people. He talked mm-hmm. about systems that were evil, racism, economic injustice, and war.
Militarism.
Were evil systems, but he never called the Southern sheriffs or the Southern politicians or other people evil people. So he was able to make that distinction. And we need that now, especially with the polarization underway here. The point you made was the next thing on my notes. This is the fortuitous way the universe functions. A lot of people trip up with two other pitfalls regarding adversaries or opponents. One is to just reject them altogether, to deny their humanity. Oh, you just can't deal with those people. That's a pitfall because it prevents us from bringing them over to our side. And another is to feel like if we can't convert the hardcore opponents, then we're doomed. And there's another model that's called the spectrum of allies, and I've done workshops on this, where instead of seeing a kind of a polarized, binary, us versus them thing, realize that people exist on a spectrum of positions, from people who are strongly opposed to us and trying to, you know, vigorously oppose what we're working for, to people on our side who are strongly for us, and people in the middle who are undecided and have mixed feelings, and people near the middle who might be sort of opposed to us but not doing much about it, or people who agree with us but aren't doing much about that. And so what this model says is devise strategies for people at each point along the spectrum. It'll be different strategies for people at each position, and try to figure out some way to get them to move one notch over. So for somebody who is strongly opposed to us and fighting us hard, what strategies could we do to cause them to not fight us so hard, even though they might still oppose us, but maybe soften a bit? Or for people who are opposed to us but not doing anything about it, what can we do to get them into a middle ground where they can really see both sides or be neutral, and so forth? So each spectrum, each position on the spectrum, if we can devise strategies to move people one notch over, it shifts the whole weight of the population.
Right. There's, you know, in the immigrant work that we've been involved with, the Strengthening Sanctuary, we work with police departments and sheriff's departments around. Now we try to build a relationship. That doesn't mean that we let them make the decisions, but we keep pointing out, uh-huh. you know, the various needs and the opportunities and the benefits of adopting policies yeah. that protect immigrants.
Yeah.
And there's been some, we've had some major breakthroughs. Major breakthroughs in Olympia. There was there's a police officer in Yelm, had a you know, kind of a real awakening in the discussion, and he pointed out, he says, gee, he says, if I was an immigrant, I'd be afraid right now.
Good.
And it's something uh-huh. that he hadn't thought of before.
Yeah, but if you handle the conversation, keep face to face.
Right.
Keep the conversation going.
Right.
And find ways so somebody can open up a bit.
But we go back. I mean, we've hit some, you know, brick walls. But we go uh-huh. back
yeah.
again and yeah. again and say, you know, do you favor breaking up families? Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was, it's relationship even with people that are, you're not going to necessarily agree with.
Right.
Can be important in the movements.
And that's consistent with the model I just described. It's a good example. I want to, Bob, could you hand us the photos that Holly brought? Part of what we do is work together with other people, bring a lot of people together, people different from ourselves. Holly had founded decades ago Skagit Citizens for Nuclear Disarmament.
Right, we stole the name from England.
They had a campaign for nuclear disarmament.
Right.
And you worked with a variety of people, including the Swinomish tribe in LeConnor,
right.
Skagit County.
Whom I've heard Bob has some connections with, two old friends.
So show us the photo. Tell us what the photo means.
This is one of my ideas that came up in, this was 1983, the Dulles brothers had an idea of making sister cities around America with countries or with towns in Russia. This was our LeConnor town photo for Olga, Russia, and we got together on the reservation on Swinomish, on the side of the Swinomish slough with LeConnor there in the background, and I went to the tribe and asked the elders if they would mind if we would do this action with this photograph on the shore of Swinomish Beach, and they said, sure, we'd love that. And so some kids showed up from the res, and also many of the people who were working in our peace movement. We had a banner here that said, Greetings, Olga, which was done by a friend of ours who spoke and wrote fluent Russian. And we dressed up in our garb, our various professional outfits. I'm there with my guitar. Robert Sund, the poet, is there with his poetry and his hat on. And so many people came with their outfits on. And we just wanted to show the people of Olga, Russia, what we were like and who we were. And I wrote a song called Song for a Russian Mother, which got some play in other places as well. And until recently, I thought, well, that one's done, you know, but it's back again. Mm-hmm. So it's about understanding and caring for each other. So that was LeConnor in 1983. But as we were saying, persistence of resistance, some things take a long time to bear fruit. And this particular project took 38 years, because just last year, and then a few years before that, we heard from a young woman in Olga. We never heard a word. We dropped this activism into the hopper, and nothing came back. And so we were wondering, well, did they hear us? Did they see us? And yes, they had. They had taken our stuff, put it in the museum, and kind of forgotten about it. Uh-huh. And so this young woman wrote to us and said, we're thrilled to hear from you, and we want to be part of your world. So now we are part of that world, and that was our LeConnor Town photo. Yeah. And
Holly?
Yes,
there is
Bob.
Up at Swinomish, I was up at a spiritual encampment, and there's one woman is going to start the fire to start it off, and she's got a flint, and she's going like this, and I'm thinking, somebody give her a match, and she's trying it, and nothing will light, and she goes on, she's talking, and I thought, hey, come on, someone's got to light her or something, because she needs to light this fire, get it going. And so finally, they bring out some dry leaves, and she's and with a spark, it all starts up. He says, goes to show, when conditions are right, it only takes a spark.
Wow, that's beautiful.
Yeah. As a native
wonderful.
Wisdom.
Yeah, they are very beautiful. Yeah. And we actually worked together quite a lot in the peace movement, too. We had many activities together on the res and in the longhouse and in other places on the reservation. We respected them and their initiations, and they respected us. And the work we were all doing together, including fighting that nuclear power plant on the wild and scenic Skagit River.
And now people are working with native peoples around not just this country, but other countries in stopping pipelines and
so important
fracking and all, I mean, all kinds of
uranium
stuff.
Mining.
There's all kinds of stuff and good collaboration. Yeah. And fortunately enough, people are willing to have native people in the leadership roles rather than have, I'm a white guy, let me show you how to do it.
We never had that feeling, and I'm glad, but that can happen.
You get some of that sometime, but now there's a respect for native leadership.
That's right.
So yeah, I want to, you've got another photo.
Well, do you want me to show you the other?
Yeah, let's do that.
I'm so fond of town photos. Because this is one that was done for Beyond Hiroshima, which was our local organization that, like you, wanted a nuclear freeze, but only 30-some years later, after you two had done your work in the 80s and or had been part of it. Yeah. This was the town photo across the street from the lake, just there on the lake with the Capitol in the background, and this brought together a coalition of lots of organizations, including the Quakers and the Rachel Corrie Foundation and the Fellowship of Reconciliation and the Vets for Peace and FOR, oh, I already said them, and various people like the movie team that made Conviction. Hold that up there, Bob, in a way that's not. So this was taken the very day that the debut of Conviction was shown at the Capitol Theater. So it brought together a whole lot of movements, plus got us a nice audience for the show, which was part of my plan.
And tell people what that movie is.
This DVD is of Ardith and Carol and Jackie, who were nuns with the Plowshares movement, and they did a demonstration at a nuclear missile silo in Colorado, where they poured their blood on the top of a nuclear missile silo that was bigger than this studio, and they hammered on it with their little ball peen hammers, which, as you know, can do devastating work, damage. And they just did a number, and then here came the MPs, and they tore down the fence. The women had just clipped it nicely and opened it, but the MPs came with their Humvees, and they tore down the fence, destroyed it, and threw the women down. They thought they were tall, mustachioed men. That was how they were described, Jackie said. And they threw them on the ground, and they took them to jail, and they kept them for a long time. And then they put them all in federal prison for 3 years, you know, because of this Plowshares action, sponsored by the Berrigan brothers in that grand tradition.
Yeah.
So this is the film of that. It's called Conviction.
A great documentary.
And Brenda Fox was here in the side of the picture, and I'm over there waving, and gosh, Bob's in there, and are you in here? You're in here somewhere.
Yeah, I'm in there someplace,
Yeah, there's a bunch of us. This was a great idea. Plus, it's a good way to make money if you sell, you know, prints to people who want to print. So this worked together in our in our work, didn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks for holding that up, Bob. Yeah.
And in your work in the Skagit Valley, tell us about Magic Skagit as a way to use music to support the campaign on the nuclear plant that we talked about.
This was lovely. I got up to the Valley in 77 and moved up there permanently in 80, but I moved up with my little daughter in 79. And they had this full-fledged music festival happening every summer called Magic Skagit. And every year, the people gave their time and their talent and the food from the co-op and various other things to support live music. People paid to come in, and we raised money for the lawyer every year. Mm-hmm. You know, and he took about $30,000 a year. People were already involved. The Skagit Citizens for Against Nuclear Plants, SCAMP, was already going strong. And all I really did there was get involved as a singer. And people like Tom Robbins were involved, and Tom Chapin, and Harry Chapin, and Linda Waterfall, and wonderful people who were great musicians who were just traveling through. But that music festival was famous, and it happened in July every year, and we raised enough money to finally get it on the referendum. And that, as you know, the earthquake helped us seal the deal. But it was all, it was Native people, it was Christian people, it was regular pagans, it was vegetarians, it was meat eaters, it was, you know, as much diversity as we could muster up there at that time. And it was young people, too, and they loved it. They, the kids and everybody loved it. You remember it?
Yeah.
Of course you do.
Yeah.
Tell us about the Cassini mission that had 72 pounds of plutonium on the rocket. And tell us about that.
This was
issue and what you did.
This is an instance of the cause reaching out to me on Democracy Now! In 1996. And I heard about this plutonium-filled rocket. on the launch pad, and I knew that one tiny little grain of plutonium can cause cancer in a whole bunch of people. So I thought, holy maloney, what are they doing with 72 pounds? So I wrote a song called Poison Arrow, and I heard about Bruce Gagnon, whom I'd met years before in Florida, and I sent it off to him, and I called him, and I said, oh, please, can I be on your platform at the... And he said, no, we've got no room. We've got too many wonderful people talking. I went, oh, that's okay. So I sent him the song, and he actually literally said he fell off his chair when he heard it. And I thought, oh, that sounds like a cool picture. And he listened to it and immediately called me up and said, yes, are you coming to Florida? And I said, yes, I will be there for other things. So I got to go. And the first, you know, I met amazing people, and there were hordes of people, busloads of them, who'd come from the other side of Florida to go to Cape Canaveral and or Cape Kennedy, where, you know, we climbed across the fence, and I sang on the platform, and Michio Kaku spoke, and Bruce spoke, and Carl Grossman spoke, and it was quite a wonderful lineup of marvelous people who really had been working in the issue, because that Cassini mission, if it had blown up in the atmosphere, which we were all terrified it would have completely destroyed Florida and many places north and south of it, east and west. And one of their solutions was, if anything happened, they could just dig out the soil over Florida and dig it down and take it to some unknown dump somewhere. Yeah. Fortunately, it didn't happen, but they did make the launch. Cassini has reached Europa, has poisoned that moon up there at Saturn with its little uranium bomb. Boom! But at least we got them to stop doing the U-turn in the atmosphere, which gives it an extra slingshot effect.
Right. The intent, the design was to have it loop around and use Earth's gravity, coming real close to Earth, and use that gravity to add trajectory boost. Yeah.
And we got them to take that hundreds of miles further out, or as far as we could. Yeah. So that was a good thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's there now. But, you know, they also, after that, we talked about developing missions that had unfolding solar wings. Germany had developed something like this. Instead of plutonium in ridiculous amounts, unfolding solar wings could get just as far and just as basically fast. There's no hurry. After all, it's going to be there. It's been there for a while. So that was another wonderful inroad that was made in that movement, and it still exists today.
Yeah.
I mean, they're still arming space. And every year have a big meeting in Colorado Springs, Colorado, where the military drags out all of its space war equipment and they sell it to the military. Yeah. And everybody has a whopping good time. And at the same time, you know, is practicing up for nuclear war in space, which Michio Kaku was dead set against, and formed an entire group of scientists, several thousand, who refused to work on it.
Right.
Because it was... third-rate science. It wasn't even real science.
Yeah.
And it still misses. You've got, you know, your Reagan's idea of defense, and here's the bullet that's going to hit it. Oh, but wait! It never quite makes it.
Yeah, the whole Star Wars, the whole Strategic Defense Initiative, which people call Star Wars, is a fraud, and it was. That was the third TV program I did when I started my series back, this would have been April of 87, was about how the Reagan Star Wars thing was a fraud. But every Congress and every president has kept it funded for decades now, and just throwing billions. It's so fraudulent that the only way they could make it hit in their tests was to put a homing device on the thing. Even then, sometimes they would miss.
It was
all baloney.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to just catch one more thing with you that you've done using music. You mentioned the Raging Grannies a bit. I want to do a little bit more of that and then move on to some other topics. Okay. But all across Canada and parts of the U.S., Raging Grannies have taken some songs that people know the tunes to and rewritten the words.
That's
and they
correct.
Performed with great messages and great wit. And now we have one in Olympia. I've enjoyed the Seattle. In fact, I did a TV program with Seattle Raging Grannies quite a number of years ago.
Those are famous ladies, and they're terrific, and we actually have one of them now with us.
Yeah.
We have some beautiful activists in that group, Bortai Hargrove, Pat Holm, Carolyn Treadway, Carolyn Farnham, Carol Farnham, who was with the Raging Grannies in Seattle.
Janet Jordan,
and Marilyn Dungan, you know, and myself, and I think, and occasionally Barb Scavese and Sue Langham. We have some really go-getting women.
Yeah.
And we have lovely hats. And Roseanne Rantz, who gives us her home. But we do a lot. We have a lot of fun. We rewrite traditional melodies with pithy new verses that we then inflict upon various city councils. I mean, entertain. And it's so much fun.
Yeah. And
it's
all
really
kinds
good.
Of public events that people need to be on the alert to do this.
It is fun.
We talked a bit about attitudes, and, you know, the actions that we do, the actual things that we do are important, but also important are the feelings and attitudes that we hold that support the actions that we do, that lead to those actions. And I believe that we have to design our organizing about whatever issues we work on to replace the negative feelings like cynicism and despair with positive feelings like hope, self-confidence, a positive long-term vision, things we've talked about in this program. But I just want to mention that I think these attitude things that underlie the actions that we do are crucial, and we need to be attentive to that. A lot of people avoid dealing with the serious issues like the climate and nuclear weapons and so forth because it's just too scary. They have psychological defenses that where people don't want to expose themselves to these horrible things. So I think a lot of what we have to do in our organizing work needs to find ways to get past people's defenses to help people understand these things. And the work of the Raging Grannies and the arts in various ways can help with that. Coming at things from a spiritual standpoint can help with that rather than just rational facts. So I just want to lay that out there as we need to be strategic in reducing the psychological barrier so people will be able to hear the message and understand it. Boy, are we behind time.
Bob's done more than I've ever realized on the various fronts.
In some issues, but one of the things that you've done that's so important is the music. And I think using the arts is so important. You need to touch the hearts as well as the minds.
It's true.
There was art, poetry.
Paintings. We used to have an art show every year of the most famous Skagit artists. I mean, people who would bring in thousands of dollars with their paintings. And Guy Anderson for one, Tom Robbins for another. He would do stamp art. It would sell for hundreds. Guy Anderson would sell something for $5,000 at auction. Uh-huh. He would just do it often. Hello, would you like this brown piece of paper with a guy? Yes, $1,002. We found ways to make money that were fun, that got people together, and really made a difference. And that went on for years.
Right, and because we need to change people's hearts and stuff as well as their minds and their, you know, political voting and their economic activities and stuff.
And artists are quick to do that to help you.
And one of the basic principles of grassroots organizing is that nothing will happen by itself. If you want something good to happen, we gotta get out there and find ways to make good stuff happen and work with other people to do that and anticipate what's going to be the next step ahead. So I'm working on this now to help us get to there, but maybe I can lay the groundwork for the next step that somebody else or I will need to do in order to help us move ahead. And if we have that kind of a dynamic there, we can make a lot more progress than just being in a reactive mode. Oh, they did this, now we got to say no. They did this other thing, now we got to say no. Let's organize also for what we want instead.
Absolutely. Vision is so important. I don't want to interrupt what you probably have to say, but I'm thinking kids, when I'm a substitute teacher, and sometimes it's funny, but there are things that I've dealt with, for example, writing plays for kids as an artist in the schools, that are about peace, that are about living peacefully, that are about meeting the new girl who might speak Chinese or Spanish or whatever, and living together peacefully with them, and in fact, even being good enough for aliens to meet you and take you on as a species, which, I don't know, sometimes can be a little dodgy. But the point being that we want young people to be involved, and I think some of us are seed people as well. You know, we're part of an organization or we're part of a movement that gives us strength, but we're also part of something that we're carrying inside of us, and it's a seed. I think of us as seed people to help understand what's real.
Yeah.
For the future, not necessarily for us personally, and then go forward. What do you think?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's like we need to do that. It's a sacred or some kind of important. Yeah.
But having young people involved, I think, is important in the movement. I mean, you mentioned there are so many things where both from the gun activism that's happening, Greta Thunberg.
Yeah.
And I mean, one thing that kind of moved me was this recent spelling bee where 8 kids, most of them were immigrants, but they were able to compete together, not against one another, but they competed together, and 8-1. They broke the banker. Yeah. The bank of words and the spelling bee.
I hope they gave them each a big prize.
Yeah. So, you know, all of us started doing this kind of work when we were young people.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to find ways to help keep that going as people come along and not have us kind of block the way.
But we also need to find a way to communicate with young people. And oftentimes that's difficult. But, you know, the stuff through music is an important way. But there's other ways. Because a lot of young people have some very important views and values.
Through theater, through hip-hop. Hip-hop's huge.
Yeah.
And through all kinds of, through dance, through painting, all of that, through sewing, through art, you know, of any kind. It's true. And they have also all the media now. They've got all the social media, which can be used for good or for hurting people. And once you get into that, learning how to do it for the good of other people, it's huge. It's really nice. Yeah.
But also being creative is something. I mean, we've got to be open to letting creativity flow.
Beyond the kinds of things we've talked about already, issues we worked on and different activities we've done, are there other lessons learned that we haven't yet mentioned? Other things like, oh, here's something that turned out to be useful and could be replicated.
Let's look meaningful and not. I think that's very important too. Looking meaningful, you really understand what you're saying. Yeah, I think there are lots of things that we may not have mentioned. For example, you don't always meet with a great success right away.
Yeah.
And it takes a while. It took 38 years for us to hear back from Olga.
Yeah, what a story. That was fun.
You know, and it took, the American Indian Movement is still going, although you may not notice it there much. Mm-hmm. But I worked a lot with John Trudell when he was on the road, and what a poet and what a man and what a political activist he was. Hope, as you say, equals revolution. Some of us are waiting for the revolution. We want that network moment where you lean out the window and you go, I can't take it anymore. But that doesn't happen, you know, necessarily.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think?
Well, there's one example of that is, you know, learning from the wisdom from people who've been through struggles. Mm. There was Noel Parrish, who coordinated a lot of the solidarity with Standing Rock activities here in Olympia. There was then when Trump came in and pushed the thing through finally, there was, you know, I asked her how she's feeling about this. And she says, well, you know, it's difficult, but, you know, you've got to realize that what we're in is not a political struggle. It's a spiritual struggle.
Yes, it is.
Political struggles appear to be over soon. Political struggles. Spiritual struggles are very long in time. It takes a long time moving through spiritual struggles.
Mm-hmm.
And these are people that have been oppressed for 400 years, but there's wisdom and being able to listen to that. And that's one of the things that I fear that we have some, in our culture, all of us, I think, possess some subtle racisms. And sometimes we don't have the time to listen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
to people that are different from us in any way, and that's something we've really got to work on.
Yeah. Fran Peavy went around with a sign. She was a great actor. Remember Fran?
Yes, yes.
And she had a sign that said, American willing to listen.
This was during the Vietnam War. Yeah. She went to France, sat in the park in Paris, and said, an American willing to listen. And people came and talked to her.
They did.
I heard her tell the story at Seattle decades ago.
She wrote
and then I got the book.
About it. Yeah, it's wonderful. I opened a concert for her.
Oh, good.
Nice, great person.
We're just about out of time. Just about out of time. There's so many more things that could be said. And it's a good thing we didn't have more people here, or else we have to fight our way through to get every possible
thing. That wouldn't be the grassroots way.
No, no.
We have to be kind and gentle.
Yeah.
But struggle still.
But still struggle.
Yeah, yeah.
Under
yeah.
the table.
And you know, the funny thing is that if I had two other people on this topic, we'd have all kinds of different stories, examples, insights, lessons learned, and so forth, and that would be fun to do. And I've got some people queued up that I'd like to do this kind of a topic with again sometime in the future. So, there are all kinds of details that we need to be attentive to besides the big picture, besides the long term. Spell people's names correctly. Return phone calls. I mean, some basic things that are just practical and really just are crucial. I want to thank Holly Gwinn Graham and Bob Ziegler. I'll be posting information to my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. They can watch this video there. They can watch a thorough summary that I'll type up of what we said, and lots of sources of information, including a few books and some websites and so forth. Information about workshops I conduct about nonviolent grassroots organizing and so forth. I want to, besides thanking Holly and Bob, I want to thank all the people who've been watching. And encourage people to do what you can. The political and economic elites do not voluntarily give up their power. It's up to us to find ways to provide justice through things that we do and the hearts and the brains that we apply. You can get information about a wide variety of issues related to peace, social justice, and nonviolence through my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. Call me at 360-491-9093. We are all one human family. We all share one planet. We can create a better world, but we all have to work at it. And the world needs just exactly what you have to offer. Thanks.